Joining us now to talk about a variety of issues, including fissures, mineral deposits, and what happens to all those rocks at the Mining Museum, is Lee Allison, the state geologist and director of the Arizona Geological Survey. Good to have you here. Thanks for joining
us. Thanks, Tim.
What happens to all those rocks?
Some of it is going to go back to the people who donated it, loaned it, but the materials that belong to the museum, there's still a question long term. So the survey has offered our assistance to the Historical Society, and we've got the University of Arizona Mineral Museum. We're all working together to provide technical support and expertise as they pack things up. And also, if things are going to go out on loan or on display, we're going to provide technical support to them.
The idea of a mineral collection is one thing, but there are other things. There are journals, there are maps, there's research mm-hmm. dating back, you know, over 100 years. What happens to all that stuff?
That's actually been transferred over to the Geological Survey. In January, we took over the department when they ran out of money, and we've kept the doors open for all their historical records and files. A lot of it's irreplaceable, one-of-a-kind documents going back 150 years. So the legislature's just formally transferred the department and its assets. So come July 1st, we will be operating those and make sure they're available.
Historical Society says we will include mining and mineral stories and the history of that in the new Arizona experience. Can they do that? Is that viable?
Wow, it's a big challenge to cover not only the history of Arizona, but the future of Arizona and the five C's and put all of that together in one building. And so I think it's pretty clear that they're not going to have anywhere near the space they had for minerals and mining displays. So there are other mining museums around the state. There's a big mineral museum in Tucson. So we're all going to work together to make sure that the assets are preserved, they're in good homes, or if there's temporary storage, that things are taken care of until a longer-term home is found for them.
All right, very good. I want to get now to other concerns, including seismic hazards mm-hmm. near Palo Verde. We saw what happened in Japan. Everyone's obviously concerned about that. Talk to us about what you found out there, what you reported to the Corporation Commission.
Well, a lot of people think Arizona doesn't have earthquakes. We do. We have not had a major damaging earthquake since territorial days, and so that's good news, but it also lulls us into a false sense of security to some extent. We've had a magnitude 7.5 earthquake just over the border in Sonora in 1887 that did a lot of damage across southern Arizona. Now, fortunately, people had a lot of this information when Palo Verde was being built. So it's built in one of the most quiet areas in Arizona for earthquake activity. Mm. So that was intentional. So that's a good place to start with. Also, when they designed it, it was intended to withstand a magnitude 8 earthquake at a distance of 100 kilometers or about 72 miles. So that's what it's designed for. And we don't see any earthquake capable faults in that region that would produce a magnitude 8.
But wasn't a monitoring station out there vandalized not too long ago?
3 years ago, we set up the first statewide seismic monitoring network in the history of Arizona. And we had them scattered around the state. And one of the stations we specifically located was west of Palo Verde to make sure that we were collecting the kind of information that would give the plant operators the newest information about how the ground responds to earthquakes coming from California, say. Unfortunately, somebody stole all of the equipment, power, the communications, the transmission, so it's gone, and we didn't have the money to replace it.
Yeah.
So we focused more on keeping the rest of the network up and operating and lost that station.
Let's talk more about this network, the seismic monitoring network. I think we just saw a map there for a second. If we could show that map again regarding, it shows where seismic activity is around the state. It looks like a lot is clustered up there near Flagstaff. What's going on there?
Right. Well, if you think about the San Francisco volcanic field, we have 600 volcanoes, and the youngest one is less than 1,000 years old. In geologic terms, that's yesterday. So we have a very active, potentially active volcanic region up there, and there's a lot of shifting and moving of the ground down at depth and adjusting. And so we're picking up a lot of that monitoring.
Okay.
We're monitoring a lot of those small earthquakes.
This monitoring effort, though, am I wrong here? But I thought the funding was going to run out for this pretty soon, isn't it?
Right. We got federal funding to buy the equipment, install it, and we're doing a three-year study with all three universities in the state to try to assess a modern interpretation of the seismic hazard across the state. That federal money runs out in June. So we're going through a process right now trying to see, can we redirect money from other projects or find it from other sources to keep the network running, which is why we didn't replace the one station that was stolen. We want to keep it running as long as possible.
You mentioned Palo Verde. There is, correct me if I'm wrong, one fissure out there near the generating station, correct?
Right. There is an earth fissure near the facility. It's within their grounds, but it's no threat to the facility.
Other fissures of note in Arizona. I think we have a map on this one as well. There we go.
Yeah. That's the Maricopa and Pinal County area, and it shows the a couple of the dozen study areas, as we call them. There are four counties with earth fissures due to subsidence, rapid withdrawal of the groundwater. The ground subsides, it cracks, mm-hmm. so we have these giant earth fissures form. We are now mapping them. We're about 80% done making the first comprehensive map with high-precision GPS instrumentation for the state. If you drive between Tucson and Phoenix down near Eloy, you go a little thump-thump as you go down the freeway.
Yeah.
That's an earth fissure that crosses the interstate.
Interesting.
It continues for 8 miles and crosses the Central Arizona Project Canal.
But that canal is retrofitted for that, isn't
it? It's specially lined, and they come back and retrofit it to make sure that it doesn't tilt the wrong direction or open up and drain the canal.
Good for them.
Yes.
real quickly, we just saw a hole in the ground. I know we have another picture of this. Didn't a horse get swallowed up? I mean, we're looking at it right now. This is out in Queen Creek, correct?
Right. That's in the summer of 2007 during the monsoon season. And 2 years earlier, a mile south of there, that same fissure opened up overnight, and a homeowner's yard disappeared the same way this did.
My goodness.
This one, the rains were so intense, it opened up so quickly, the horse was trapped, and after about 32 hours of trying to rescue it, it died of exertion.
My goodness. Okay. And this is rare, but not... not all that rare, is it?
Not all that rare. In North Las Vegas, they lost 243 homes to earth fissures. We've been lucky. We have not had that same kind of devastation. But there are dozens and dozens of homes and apartments built on or next to earth fissures all over southern Arizona.
All right. Before we let you go, potash is a big deal up near, I think it's Holbrook, correct?
Yes.
What is potash, and why is this such a major factor, could be a major factor, I guess it is a major factor, as far as mineral deposits here in Arizona?
Potash is actually a term that came from the 1500s, where they would burn wood in these big pots and extract the potassium from it. So this ash came out of the pot, and they would spread it on the fields, they would make soap out of it, they would use it in glass making. Today, 95% of the potash developed around the world is used in fertilizer, and there's a worldwide shortage. The price went up almost tenfold over the last 3 years. No new mines anywhere in the world in 30 years. And we found in the last 3 years that about a quarter of all the potash in the United States lies out in the Holbrook Basin just south of Interstate 40.
And let's put this on the desk here. We just saw a shot of that. That is basically what has been excavated up?
That's a core. So it's the drill bit went down in a cylindrical drilling down 800 to 1,000 feet below the ground, cut through the potash, and it's like a dark salt, and it is. It's a potassium salt, and then you extract the potassium out of it, and it's one of the three major elements in making fertilizer.
Those three numbers you get on your bag of fertilizer.
Right. One of those is potash.
You mentioned, though, that exploration is underway, and there's a lot of deposit, but isn't a lot of that under a national park?
The center part of the deposit lies directly under Petrified Forest National Park, and it cannot be mined, it cannot be leased. But we've got a number of companies drilling out there. Right now, there's probably 40 core holes permitted or having just been drilled, and a major exploration effort out there. This could be a $1 billion investment to mine the potash, but it would be the first new mine in the world in 30 years. Wow. And our estimate is there's up to 2.25 billion tons of potash. And the price spiked at about $1,000 a ton during the run-up. It's pulled back during the recession here, but it's running about $400 a ton. So we're talking that there may be hundreds of billions of dollars worth of potash that could be mined out there in that region.
Wow, this is fascinating stuff. Lee, thank you so much for joining us.
My pleasure.
Appreciate it.
Thanks.